bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests from around the globe, featuring live in-studio performances from our very special guests. We broadcast live from the LA Talk Radio studios the first and third Saturdays of each month in stunning HD video. Thank you for tuning in to Inside the Music. Thank you. That's our show for today. And thank you for tuning in. The music speaks for itself.
Yes, it does.
Want to welcome you to Inside the Music with Will and Jack. Jack, we haven't seen you in a while. I missed you.
I know, Will.
And we show up, and there's all these male models in our room.
Oh, Lord.
What's going on here?
You're so right here. Kind. Knock it off. Stop it.
We got Morris Chestnut,
right.
Denzel. What's going on?
Oh,
well,
my goodness.
And Burt Reynolds. No, Joe Pesci.
Joe Pesci.
That's not Ron Jeremy, is it?
I'm Ron Jeremy.
Oh, my goodness.
So anyway, you know what?
I had a hair transplant.
You don't want me to take my hat off.
Listen.
Well, before we get started.
Yes.
I can pick on you for a minute.
I like that.
Okay, so you have a new single out.
I do.
You got this.
It's called Swing City.
Wait a minute. By the way, I forgot to mention Nathan Mitchell, our guest for today. That was Swing City.
Thank you.
That was a top 10 Billboard, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. It was number 7 on Billboard, number 7 on Smooth Jazz Network, but it's my first number 1 on Media Base chart.
Nice.
Congratulations.
Yes.
And
so
that
anyways,
Media Base is great because
yes, it is.
Picking on this guy.
All right.
Uh-oh.
Okay. So Will had a number 1 single recently. Like, it's still out,
actually. Oh, it's hot.
Yes.
But on Groove
hot
Music, what, 3 straight weeks you were number 1?
Yes.
Yeah.
And
but
I just got a report this morning that, you know, everyone's kind of not sure how to work streaming, but my tunes have been added on these really specific playlists on Spotify.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And you know.
That's big.
It's cool to see that stuff from your old catalog. But, yes, You Got This is the new single for my grandson.
Speaking of streaming, I don't know if you realize this, but your last single, Infinite Soul, has more than 1 million streams on Spotify.
Wow, that's awesome.
And he has 85,000 monthly listeners on Spotify. Mm. I don't know if you're aware of that, Will. I know you don't look at
so that.
So that
averages out to about $5 $5 in royalties for the month.
Actually, au contraire. Au contraire, my mon frère. This gentleman here and Robert McLean, they are bringing us into the modern world of streaming. There's money there. You gotta if you wipe the cynicism away, there's money there.
Yeah, well, you gotta get in that category, like 1 million streams.
1 million streams.
50,000 streams or something. It's not like you said, $5.
You get a left shoe for that.
Yeah.
But you know what, I wanna recognize our gallery. Not only is Nate Mitchell, he basically wakes up and drinks rocket fuel. And he carries his own fully grown stuntman with him, double, handsome young man here. If something happens to Nate, he's got this gentleman ready to step in. Look at this. This is Nate's handsome son, EJ, and you got to get on the camera. This guy's headed to Berkeley, you guys, and watch out.
Yep.
Yes.
Proud
and
of him.
Naturally
congrats,
talented,
brother.
And I last time I saa him, he was just a young man.
So Will, we got to get an appointment to have him on the show then, right?
I know. I can't wait to have him. And also want his hairline, too. I'll borrow your hair and give it back to you next week. Look at that. Jesus. That's a proceeding hairline. Jesus.
Right.
Anyway, you know, I am really grateful to see these guys this morning. And I haven't seen, we haven't done a show in, how long have we?
A month.
A month.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
And this man, Alan, I know you know him. There's no agenda. He'll call me like in the middle of a day and just talk about albums with no agenda, just joy of music.
Right.
Wow. None of the regular musician stuff where we're critiquing stuff. And it's just a joyous thing. And he'll wear out records, literally. Yeah. Uh-huh. Stuff that you'd be surprised at. And the only thing he does, though, sometimes I feel good and I don't want to talk business. How are your streams today? Are you looking at streams? No, I'm just driving on 111 in the desert. Can you have a guy send me a chart from your left?
When he says no, I hang up on him.
You know, sometimes you just want to like flow. And,
right.
But he's a kicker. If this guy's a great manager, by the way, too.
Oh, wow.
But, you know, I have to say something about Nate, and this is just from the heart. I don't think I've met anyone so naturally talented with just... You know, he's almost got too many things in his tool bag, you know, producer, singer, entertainer, and just a natural musician. And you don't feel any theory coming into the playing. You just feel heart and soul. And you don't get that a lot in
in certain level of music. And
yeah.
Are we starting the interview yet? Are these things on?
No, well, before we start the interview.
You're starting to pick on me still. See?
I want to introduce Alan Gray.
Yes.
Thank you for having me back.
The promoter at Harvell's Jazz Club in Long Beach.
Yes.
And tell us what you're doing there and tell us about the show you got coming up.
Well, first of all, I got to thank you guys, man, for having me back again. This is my third trip.
Always a pleasure, Alan.
My third trip, so I appreciate it. Thank you. Harvell's downtown Long Beach. I do what's called Quiet Storm Sundays. They're usually a Sunday afternoon, either 3 to 6 or a 4 to 6, depends on the artist. You know, some people like straight 90-minute set. Some people like to take a break and do two 45-minute sets. So it just depends as far as the time is concerned. But I have tomorrow Mr. Nathan Mitchell. And I have to tell you, I talked to him about 3 months ago about him coming and performing. And I think we... the ink dried about, what, 2 months ago or so? And oh, he calls me a month later. It's like, Al, guess what? I said, what? He said, man, I'm up for an NAACP Imagery Award for Outstanding Jazz Album of the Year. I said, what? I said, wow, man. Well, first, congratulations. And second, that's going to be promotion heaven. Great.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was happy to hear that he was nominated for that award. They had the award show last night. You want to talk about that?
Well, last night was the actual the dinner. Right. It was off air, and I mean, it was literally 1,500 remarkable, gifted celebrities, actors. Mm-hmm. I met Morgan Freeman. I mean, this is the caliber.
You got to pinch yourself. Right. Were you like, what am I doing
here? I mean, that's kind of the atmosphere. Honestly, in walking into the atmosphere, it was very unique because you walk in with a mindset, man, do I actually even belong here? And then you walk in, you're greeted with handshakes, hugs, and hellos. Hey, I remember you. Let's take a picture. Oh, I'm a fan of you. And you're like, simply like, wow, you know?
Yeah.
So it was just so warm. But last night, they actually did a lot of the categories last night. They did my category last night.
Oh, okay.
I did not win. I will not say I lost.
There you go.
But right. I didn't win. But I am so thankful because just the networking. My sister, Jasmia Horn, she won. She took home the award.
Congratulations, Jasmia.
I mean, you know, and Najee was there last night, and we just got a time to talk. We were in the same category, but it was just an amazing experience. Today we are doing the live taping, and hopefully you will see me and this young man on the red carpet.
Yeah.
So, it was just an amazing experience, and like I was telling family and friends, you know, what this did, it showed me personally that it can be done.
Mm-hmm. Well, how'd this come about, the nomination?
Well, what happened is, well, last year, this time, Jasmine Gent, she went up for nomination. So, and I noticed, I'm like, Jasmine's an independent artist. So I was trying to figure it out. Everything was just kind of clicking. How did Jasmine get on this ballot as an independent artist? So, you know, me and her talk, and I just kind of started doing my little homework, and that's one thing I'm always thinking a couple steps ahead. So I started doing my homework. I found out the submission process and all that. There is really no magic to it, and there is no guarantees. You know, the only thing is because I am the owner of my own label, I was able to submit it. So we submitted it.
Oh, okay. If not, your label has to do it?
Well, yeah, right. So being that, you know, I mean, I have my label. We submitted the project, got a call back, was like, hey, you made the first cut. I'm like, oh, and then.
Were you startled when you got the call?
Well, the thing was that when I got the first, I was like, oh, wow.
Because you got a lot of buddies that do practical jokes.
Right, right, right,
right. Right.
One of them primarily in this room.
Yeah.
So.
Don't talk about Alan that way.
Well, that doesn't surprise me.
So what's funny is that I received a call from that I was nominated for the 2019 Breakout Artist of the Year with Smooth Jazz Network. So me and BK Jackson were going head to head on that one. You know, got to calculate votes. So on the day of the decisions for that awards, I lost that to BK. BK calls me and was like, you know, I kicked your butt, right? I was like, wait a minute. Thank you for being so humble. So then we're just laughing. He was like, I don't think I want this award, though. So I'm sitting here like, why? He was like, you don't know. I was like, what do you mean? He was like, you need to go look on this website. And I went and streamed. So BK actually is the one that told me that I was nominated.
For the
NAACP. I had no clue. He was following it.
Really?
And BK won. And the same day he called me, he was like, so do you want to switch places? So it was just, it was an experience.
By the way, Wilden, I was checking Ancestry.com to see if he has a black blood in him so he can be, he's taking notes.
I'm olive. I'm olive. I carry a swatch with me and not white. I'm olive.
Oh, my God.
So, you know, I hope this doesn't sound maudlin, and I can't spell it, but I can say it. But we have a really interesting history that I
yes,
cherish. 2010, it blows
11,
my mind.
That's 11.
2011. 2011. That's right. Because I had just made it through throat cancer and finally got to play. I went to do the Jacksonville Beach Jazz Fest, and I went and did this really cool club in Florida. And parallel to this, on another plane, his wife, his beautiful wife, had passed on, and he kind of was in a spot like, I'm kind of done for a while. I got to just chill. We both came back. That was actually my first show back.
That was our first show.
My first show back with the throat. I was even...
Well, I met you that year at Thornton Winery.
And I was wearing a turtleneck because I had a scar on my neck in July in Florida.
Wow.
It looked like a Janet Jackson snake. I'm like, hi, welcome. How's the humidity here? And he had come back, and I just, the minute I heard him too, I thought, this guy's great. I wonder how, he must have been smooth jazz forever. He goes, yeah, this is my first smooth jazz gig. And I was just so startled. And then we shared our backstories. And it was very heavy, you know. And usually when the show and the moving parts, you're just trying to just do self-preservation to do your show.
Right.
But I was just really charmed by that he... We both came back for different reasons, and we both had an appreciation to be back on stage. And, you know, he's been a house guest, and he's so busy that he can't actually come out half the time. But, you know, I've seen his trajectory, and I'm just freaking amazed. You know, if you're lucky to have him as a sideman, that your material gets learned, you can literally walk off the stage, and the energy goes up and not down. And to see him have an artist career now, it's really exciting.
What's funny is I was very, you know, going into it, major introvert. You know, I was the guy that would sit on the side. I will never forget this.
You know, I don't think you're alone on that. There's a lot of people you watch go on stage and tear it up.
Oh, man.
And then when they're by themselves, you get them. They're not really.
Oh, yeah. But you know what? But I was that, and what was thinking, I was that way on stage as well. So I remember I got the guitar, and I was behind my keyboard playing the guitar.
No, you know,
I was mobile.
I mean, that's the reason why you get a guitar.
I can move around, but it was just, I was just stuck in that hole of just of introvert of performance, and I was kind of scared to break. I will never forget. We were at Spagantini's.
I was there. I'm pretty sure
it was my first show at Spags. This guy, Will, grabs my arm, escorts me off stage.
That's Will.
And I think we were playing Play That Funky Music.
Yeah, we were.
Will put me on top of a table. So that was officially my first table stance.
Yes.
You know, I've had...
Were they throwing dollars at you?
He was a virgin until then. Now he's a furniture guy.
Exactly.
Nathan Mitchell making it rain back in 2001.
I think I did that with Jeff Ryan in Phoenix, too.
Oh, my gosh. That was the first time. He literally put me on top of the table, and that was the first table dance I did.
You know what? You're not the first guy, either, that Will's done that, too. Oh, you did it to Jeff Ryan, too, right?
I enjoy doing that because, you know what? I find that some performers... They feel like, and I don't mean this in a bad way, that there's a bubble. And the minute, in a good way, you take control of the show, you're like, oh wow,
yeah,
this is my house. I can entertain, and because most musicians are like, am I executing this right? Oh boy,
right.
And the minute I like to start my show, it's a little bit hacky sometimes, and I'm silly, I don't do it anymore. But I saw this performance artist, and I said, how much did you charge to do this? $15,000. He's one of those guys that does the painting upside down, spins it around, and it's John Lennon. Uh-huh. You know those guys at a corporate gig.
Oh wow!
But he came out with this like arrogant flair, and it was funny and dramatic music. And he puts a dot on the canvas. He turns around and he goes, "Thank you. That is my show." And I go, "What? $15,000?
Wow!"
So you know what's funny is this is that
when he took control of the crowd, and I thought, "Oh wow!" I kind of did that.
The one thing I love about Will, because you know Will is not just a musician; he's an entertainer. And that was the day that literally I had to start looking at performance from a whole nother point of view. Not just being a musician. You know, a lot of times we play for the appeal to get other musicians' approval.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know, as a musician playing for another musician, we understand the language, but you have people out there that are lovers of the music. They may not understand that language.
Right.
So, but Will is him, and I'll definitely say Nick Colione, who I toured with for years. They understand performance. Yes. You know,
it's relating to your audience.
Yeah, Brian Culberson. I love Brian.
Marcus Anderson.
You know, they understand performance. They understand that sometimes you have to simplify the sound. So that way it appeals to the listener, but give them a performance. Not so much musicianship, but it's just finding that right balance.
The funny thing is, you know, sometimes, like when we stand on the table, you know, what people don't know is, like, I'm the first guy up at 8 a.m. staring through mouthpieces and going through reeds and going through 2-5-1s and changes. You're still getting down. You're not trying to get over. Mm-hmm. You want to get down. So even when you're standing on a chair, you're still getting down. You're not getting over. And sometimes some musicians that don't have that hang, they're like, I don't know, is this John Coltrane? What's going on here? See, I don't worry about the jazz police. Just like a comedian from a Chris Rock, you know, their skill set for what they do is just so defined, and they own their point of view. And one guy's a crank, one guy's silly, and one guy's a, you know, when I see someone like you, I know the skill set behind everything he does. I mean, as far as it's informed. So if he stands on a chair, it's strictly to connect.
Right.
I'm not going to name names, but when another gentleman went out and started doing the out in the crowd thing, and he went up to all the pretty ladies and goes, "I'm just like you." I go, "No, I go for the people that don't look like they've got a lot of love or need celebrating. I don't go to the hot babe." Right. I'm being really authentic here with this, but I go, "No, you're not like me."
Well, you're such a liar.
But that being said, you know, in real life, when you're standing in a supermarket, you know, you see an elderly person that looks like they're being invisible, and it doesn't. I don't want to be that guy when I'm
you
know, 70. I don't want to be invisible. So at the show, you know, you want to find people that maybe don't get a lot of celebration. You know, I think that's a good thing to do. But
it is.
But anyway, back to this handsome man here. So,
can I say this real quick? Because this is really good to have somebody like Will in the business. Because, first of all, I've seen Will perform many times before. Great entertainer, like you said, connects with the crowd and plays a hell of a sax. But what I love about Will the most is that, first of all, he supports everybody.
Very supportive.
He's very supportive. And for him to take the time to come to you and say, "Hey, young man, come down here. I want you to connect with this audience."
He didn't say that. He just pulled me.
Right.
That was very nice how you said it.
Exactly.
He was just like,
right, right.
Baptism by fire.
But
and
that's
it worked.
But that's him passing down wisdom and him teaching people coming behind him
very so much
that, hey, this is how you elevate your game. And that's great to have somebody like that. And
it's,
you know,
mentorship.
He's a great guy. Yes.
It's absolutely mentorship. And you know what? And that's one of the things, even with my son, with everyone, I mean, I'm 44 years old, and I've been in the music game a long time. And one thing I have learned is this, you know, the true success of being a musician and artist is the mindset of forever being a student. If you're a student, you will always be relevant. And that's one of the biggest things that I'm trying to encourage into my son. Any young entertainer, Anyone that just comes and inquires of, okay, how do you do this? How did you get here? I listen. And I listen to those that were that are where I want to be. It doesn't matter how great your ability is, but it does matter how great your ears are. Because yeah. At the end of the day, you know, you can have the greatest skill, but if you don't have the skill set to listen,
right,
you're limiting yourself. And, right. You know, and that's one thing I constantly bounce stuff off Will.
Yeah, audiences don't strictly relate to chops. You get up there, you show great chops, you're not melodic, the audience doesn't get
yes.
it. It's like you didn't even perform.
Yes. Right.
You know? Well, the irony yeah. is, even if you're Brecker, which I just love Brecker, however, you've attained all that facility and you can basically play anything you want, somebody else will just dismiss you. That's too many notes. It's right. not soulful. So it's like, so even for Brecker, for us, or Herbie, or somebody else, you know, he reminds me of a young Herbie, because when you have this facade of appearance and soul and heart and juice, as Nick Colleone would say, you can go a long time in this genre. I mean, my heroes are like Bob James and Sanborn.
Yeah.
Sanborn, yes. 74 and a half, and wow. he's still getting on a plane more than any of us. Wow. And we all have to do it the same way. You fly in, and it's 2 o'clock sound check. I was going to say something, though. You know, maybe it's the break that we had, and we had a chance to reset, but I notice on Facebook a lot of people that we think are grinding, and you think, oh, that guy's getting it done, he's posting. I notice they don't curate. Mm. You know, sometimes if it's just like, I'm going, I just got booked, I'm me. Mm-hmm. How about saying, you know, like I try to do, I'm grinding, but I'll still say, you know, Nate Mitchell has a great CD out called Soulmate, and right. here's the link to Amazon.
Yes.
I think of more musicians that think they're grinding.
Celebrate others.
There's yes. not peer-to-peer going yeah. on, and I see that a lot of that on Facebook, and I
call you know, that being said, Greg Manning just did something interesting. I
love
you saw
that.
It. So what he's doing is, a lot of people pay homage to, you know, people of the past that came mm-hmm. before him. Mm-hmm. He's saying, I'm going to pay homage to people who are living.
Yes. Yes.
So he said, you know, so he's picking out people that had an influence on him, mm-hmm. and he's celebrating people that are alive, not people that.
Wow.
Yeah. I think it's a brilliant idea.
Oh, yeah.
It's well, a, you know what, and like, that's just recently, like, one of my newly good friends is Will Downing. Me and Will have been knowing each other for years. We've connected, definitely connected, and, you know, great times and laughter. And recently, you know, Will released a new single. I mean, I had all these posts on my wall, NAACP this, Nathan Mitchell Show this. And then I was like, well, pause. Go and celebrate. Will just dropped the new CD. That I mean, and people's like, whoa, you just kind of like insert him. I'm like, if you have to, what you want to happen for yourself, you have to make happen for others.
Yes.
If you want people to celebrate you, then you have to celebrate someone.
Yeah, you do.
You know.
And then you know what? I'm not kidding. Sometimes I wake up and go, dang, I just want to walk my dogs and see if I can find a read that works.
Right.
And somebody else is like, I'm posting, I'm doing liners all day. Me. I just got booked. Here's my tour schedule. Doesn't it look pretty? I'm like, why don't you just mention Althea or Reagan or Nate or Jeff Ryan? Show a little that you're secure with yourself, that you right. can let
well, it takes
else go.
One right. person to do it, Greg or Nathan, and then other people may think, oh, you know what?
Yeah.
You know, just the mindset. The problem is, you know, when you do social media, you have so much real estate, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So really, you know, you got 4 or 5 posts, and that's what people see, and they don't usually scroll down. Mm. So it's valuable real estate when you give up a space. That's valuable real
yeah.
estate.
But
yeah.
you know what? Buyers, sometimes like a man like Alan that has a better vision of, you know, a commodity of somebody, if he sees, God, Nate, man, he's celebrating Will Downing's albums, I'm hiring Nate. That's the kind of human I want around me, not just, I just did this all day. It's
like, right. You know, being relatable is important.
It is.
Yeah. You know, especially, yeah. I mean, the time has kind of passed where, you know, artists that are, you know, behind the glasses and behind the veil, it's like that time has kind of passed. You know, people want to be, felt like they're a part.
Well,
your audience wants to feel like they're a part.
That yes. This genre in particular really lends to that, because you know, like you go to a concert, go to Harvell's, you're going to sit at a table, You got to meet people. You got to take a picture with them. Mm-hmm. You got to sign an autograph. Mm-hmm. You can't do that. You know, people love the genre, and they love mingling with the artists who they love. Yes. Like, you go to a Katy Perry concert,
yeah, right,
and you try to get within 100 feet of her, you're going to get tackled.
Exactly.
It's not going to happen.
But you know what? That's even like with the Harvells. You know, when we were talking about just marketing, you know, of course, I'm a new artist to Alan. You know, and he's like, okay, I'm bringing a new artist that technically he's just learning about, you know, mm-hmm, to an audience that he doesn't even know if I have or not. So as we're communicating and going back and forth, he was like, man, I'm like, listen, you know what? Let's work smart. Let's not hard. So we started connecting with people that we knew were in the jazz community.
Yes. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
You know what happened? I mean, immediately. You know, these people just went out. They were the ones, they were pushing it. They were marketing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And then, too, you know, we would call certain people and like, hey, you know, could you help? They would put the word out, and then they would still come and buy a ticket, not expecting anything else. Right. They just wanted to be a support.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, you know, yeah, I want to revisit that thing.
Before we do that, on schedule, we have to stay on schedule. So, Nathan played Seabreeze Jazz Festival with Paul Brown.
And Darren Ron.
Yes. And mm-hmm, he did a killer solo.
Uh-oh.
And we just happened to have that in our archives. So, Sam, play that video.
I think we need to get the keyboard player some. Come on, Nate. This man's mad. Check this out.
That's a who's who comes to Seabreeze. Being with Paul, being with Darren on stage is always an amazing experience. Me and Paul have played together for years. Darren and I, he is a mentor. He's a big brother. He's someone that I reach out to get information with production. So I enjoyed those moments. And you'll actually prepare yourself. You will be hearing more between me, Darren, Ron, especially also Paul Brown.
Are you still on the same label as Paul, or you're not? Oh, no, you're on.
No, yeah. Right. I was. Well, let me say this, and I definitely give homage to who it's due to. Woodward Avenue Records is the first label that I was on in the smooth jazz market, and they set the tone for my artistry. They released a single called For All Eternity, which featured Nate Najjar and Marcus Anderson, and a good friend of mine who was on The Voice at the time, Mr. R. Anthony. That was my first single. From there, you know, I just kind of felt like I wanted to do something different, and I started my own label, E&M Music Group.
Which is nice.
And right now, E&M Music Group, as of to date, has 5 top 30 singles, billboards under the belt.
Wow. Very congratulations.
Nice. Thank you.
So how did all this get started?
Well, hold on a second. I'm going to interject here. So hold on a second. So, again, when I met this gentleman, we're all getting down. He's killing And we, you know, he got some outgoing males in front of him on stage, postal workers, outgoing males. And he goes, he turns to me, I've never done smooth jazz before. I'm like, what? It's like Sandborn. You guys probably didn't watch Taxi, but this character, Jim, like, would sit down like a homeless guy and all of a sudden shred on classical. Well, I guess I had lessons sometime. But anyway, so I tease Nate. When I see him, I go, who the hell are you? Where did you come from? Everybody else, I went to Berkeley. I'm a church guy. So when you sent me the bio, Nate, I go, oh, good. It says Nate Mitchell bio. Finally, I can solve the mystery. Where the heck were you born? Did you have a piano first? Did you do the band thing? Did you have a band when you were 13? And it said, I was born, and then I opened up for Nick Colleone, and I'm in his band now. What? There's nothing. So, young man, check this out. Unfortunately, this goes with the territory. People love you now, and you have a tipping effect. That festival bio crap ain't cutting it now. People want to know.
They want to know you.
I mean, right. It's a good thing to have because we're so intent on, Alan, look at this. I opened for the Yellow Jackets. I got stung by a Yellow Jacket, and I'm ready to play. They want to know you now. And a jacket's hard when I do this, but you know, I like to track this. I got to track this. It's driving me nuts. You were born in Tampa or not?
I was born in Panama City, Florida.
Okay, see that? There we go. Okay, that's it. That's our show. I got to the bottom of this. Now, is that a safe area? No. Was your mom or your dad musical?
Both. My father actually is a keyboardist, a bass player, guitar, and drummer. He sings as well. He was a deacon in the church. Also, he was in the military. So we
Army really, or
Air Force. So Air we travel Force, a baby. Lot.
So aim you high. You were a
military brat.
Me too. That's probably our connection because nothing we can take change and not worry about it. We can roll.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, military brat. So always adapting that. Is something that just comes to me naturally. I can adapt to my atmosphere.
Did he mentor you a lot? Just like, son, here's a.
Or honest, just watch. I mean, it's pretty much the same thing that happens with EJ. You know, technically, like, as he got older, I would sit down and show him various things. But everything that he's learned, everything that I learned, is basically just watching and mimicking.
Wow. So now you're, like, 7 and being absorbed by this? Or what grabbed you to do music?
What's your first instrument?
First instrument was drums. I actually started playing drums at the age of 3. My first lesson was the pots in my mom's kitchen.
That's right.
So
oatmeal boxes.
That's right.
This is good archive stuff for your website. The man of mystery is speaking.
Pots in her kitchen. I remember my grandmother's house. We would go outside, and at this time, they had like the tin steel trash cans. We would take those trash cans and set them up like a drum set.
Did you love it though? Did you love it? Like,
and we would just. Beat away.
Now, in your head, were you playing something soulful that you saw on TV, or did
it
you,
was like what in what, our head?
Were you I what mean, band were you it, trying to be?
We were church musicians, so it was like at that time all I knew was church music. So whatever, I would just hum sounds that I heard in church, and it would just play. But then, as time progressed, when I turned, I think it was 7. I think I was about 7 years old. I was actually playing. Well, I started playing drums in church, in Pentecostal church. And I was 5 years old playing a full drum set.
Wow.
So, and I could barely touch the pedals at the time. And they had a stool that was unadjustable. So I had to sit on the edge of the seat. But like, I remember.
Baby.
Yeah, right.
Did you love, could you not wait to wake up and go play? Was it that like?
Oh, yeah. Like, it was like, go for it. You know. Mm-hmm. But I remember I was like 7 or 8, and we were at. The church.
This makes me so happy.
So you being an introvert,
I didn't
you,
know any of this stuff.
Were you nervous playing in front of the church crowd?
No, never.
Yeah.
Wow. Never. Because my mind just wanted to learn, figure it out. So I remember a friend of mine, you might know him, Joseph Stallworth. He's
I
a keyboard player.
Yeah.
Me and Joseph actually were, we kind of grew up together in that area.
Did you do services together?
Yeah, we did. And he was playing keyboard, I was playing drums. So I was watching him one day, and I was like, I'm going to figure this out. So then I went to him, and he showed me. He was like, well, he showed me one chord. And he was like, you could take that chord and move it this way. That. So I went home. We had a piano. And I went and I started playing with it. Then my dad saw it, so he was like, okay, let me show you this. So he showed me how to play he was like, something like that. So I took that and was like, okay. So I started exploring. So while he was at work and I was home from school, I was exploring. Then we had records. I would put records on. I'm like, okay, let me try to figure this song out. That's, my mind was just constantly
moving. And how old are you now-ish?
Now I'm 44. So... now I'm 44.
When you were doing the piano,
that was like 7 or 8, and then eventually, what really pushed everything over?
Yes.
And this is one thing I always kind of say. You know, it's like God puts you in certain situations that you never know why you're in the situations you're in. But I was actually going to a middle school, and the middle school I was going to, my parents couldn't pick me up. So I had to walk to this lady's house that was that basically babysitted me. She had an organ in her house. So there was nothing to do. Literally, we go to the house, no toys, no cable. It's just me. It's like, what to do? And I remember one day I was like, can I play that? So she was like, go ahead. And the way she had it set up, there was a door, so you could shut the door and you can hear it in the rest of the house. So I would literally sit down and I'm like, okay, these are pedals. Oh, that's what that does. And I would literally sit there for hours and hours and hours. This is like 9. Well, no, I was 11 at the time. So, and I just kept doing it. I just kept doing it every day. That was what I did every day. Walked in the house, did that. When my parents came, picked me up, boom, every day. And eventually, I learned.
So you had to be passionate about it at that.
Very. Oh, yeah. I was determined to learn.
Yeah.
Wow. And the drums kind of, you did it when they had to.
So when did your dad finally say, like, wow, this kid's really got something?
One day, my dad was in church, and he was playing. He caught spirit and got off the keyboard. So I took the chance. I went and got on. So when he came back, he was like, what's going on here?
He had no idea.
He had no clue.
Wow.
That was it. So from that day on, it was like, all right, so you moving from drums to keys.
Uh-huh. There it is.
So.
Did you want to move from drums to keys?
I didn't care. You know, I just love playing.
Yeah.
So I had the opportunity to go to a church. I think it was Englewood for Eddie's son.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I was just mesmerized by this duo. It was a drummer and a keyboard player, and it was just, you know, we were kind of in a mode of respect, you know, but they were just killing it. And I was watching their faces, and they were just joyous about the way they played. And it was something I hadn't seen the way we do it in our thing, like we've got a mission, and we have joy, but the way they interacted with each other, it's like they could play anything, and it was so freaking cool.
Yeah.
And so now you're at church. Are you ever going outside the church realm and like hanging out with some guys that are doing Herbie Hancock?
Well, honestly, no. I mean, funk. I went from the whole style of church, from drums to keys, from keys. I went, of course, in middle school. I was in middle school band, so I learned how to play saxophone. So then I went there. That's where I learned sax. My dad was playing bass. I remember I would pick up the bass. It was always, the instrument was too large at times for me to even hold it, so I was like, just kind of let it go. But
I've heard him play sax. He's great. He can play.
Yeah, mm-hmm. So, and then.
You should bring that back in the show.
I should. I was thinking about it.
You got buddies that have
drawers. It's too many sax players, though.
I know.
It's too many.
But all your buddies have drawers of good mouthpieces.
Yes. So at 17, I actually got picked up by Bad Boy Records. And they heard me and a friend of mine, we were actually doing the R&B thing. That's when it kind of started. We were doing like talent shows in school. We won a couple of talent shows.
Just curious, what was the instrumentation like for one of those?
He was a singer, and I did all the production. And that was the thing that really captivated Puffy at the time. It's because he was trying to figure out how this 16-year-old, 17-year-old kid was playing stuff that some of his older artists was doing, and it just came with me for ease. It was just easy. So he would give me a Jodeci song. I'm like, okay, this is how they play it. And he was like, wow, you know. So, but as life transcended, you know, I got married, Oh, I met my wife at 20, at the age of 20. At the age of 23, we got married. And when we got married, I started wanting to do more gospel stuff. And I remember, and this is the biggest thing, you know, and this especially one thing I want to encourage a lot of musicians. So I was calling. I was like, okay, I need a bass player for this. I need a bass player for this. And I couldn't find one. So I taught myself.
Oh, you didn't play bass before?
No.
He's a good bass player, too. I've seen
yeah,
him.
So, yeah, so I play on all the on all my records. I'm playing bass on all my records. The bass solos, all that stuff.
Wow.
So then I wanted a guitar player. I couldn't find one. So I taught myself.
He's a great player, too, dude.
That's, I mean, and literally, so that's actually how I started playing multiple instruments. I just got tired of calling people.
Wow, man.
And was like, I just.
So on your albums, do you play mostly instruments?
I play everything on my albums.
Oh, wow.
Everything,
that's amazing.
Everything on my, all of the albums from start to finish is from these two hands.
It's the young prince right here.
So check this out. A little departure here. So you've got a great trajectory, and you're in the flow. I think I told you maybe the second time we played together, I said, dude, you need to be the guy in the middle of the stage. I know I said that.
Yes, you did.
You need to be the guy in the middle. I said, because last time I counted, there's 4,000 of us, and there's one crawling out of a rock right now. And there's about six of you guys, Brian.
James Lloyd.
Two Brians that are actually entertainer
right.
with a body of work that you can say, this is my body of work, Swing right. City. I said, you got to do it, man. I said, imagine waking up and being a sax player and starting your day like that.
Right.
And but my question was going to be, you know, when you look around and you're friends with Darren and Greg, the minute you switch, the minute you put the sign in front of your house that says, producer now open, you know, are you going to push that way? It seems like the opportunities for, or do you still have that fire to be the guy in the middle as well? Are you going to do kind of both? Because I could see, like, Greg sometimes, I don't know how Greg even, and I say this lovingly, because he's such a talented guy, but he could just stay in his studio and everyone
right,
would,
I mean. That's just his demeanor, though, yeah.
But Greg, I mean.
He's so low-key.
But he's an entertainer, too, and he's got right. he's got songs that need to be played right. for live. But do you ever see yourself like, maybe I should just not stay up all night and get on a plane and just let, do you have a fire to be a, see, I'm a entertainer, I want to produce Wildonado songs, right. and that's it.
And I think that's where I'm at right now. You know, I was doing a lot of production for a lot of people, but right now I really want to focus on getting a lot of stuff out of me. One of the biggest things that's important to me is a legacy. I want my last name to carry weight. It's wonderful to be able to love the music of Luther Vandross. He's been gone for years, but his music is still relevant. It's almost like he's still here with us. Michael Jackson, Prince. The recent loss, LA's Prince, Kobe. Yeah. You know, losing Kobe,
yeah.
it's almost like, okay, we lost him physically, but we did not lose Kobe.
I'm glad you right. said that, because there's a saxophone player in New York that I love, and he shreds. He shreds anybody. He really does. Mm-hmm. He has no songs. He has nothing. But, you know, the Academy Awards can call him. He'll shred. He can play. And you've got that ability to be everybody's sideman. Mm-hmm. You can produce. But I like that fact that, you know, at the end of the day, you want to have a body of work.
Right.
Whether or not it gets celebrated, you know, your son can go, man, Dad, that fourth album you did is really
one
great.
One of the greatest things I'm going to say is that.
The body of work, to know you have songs. I mean, when you get your set list out and you finally get rid of most of the covers, and it's all Nate Mitchell, and you go, geez, I have too many of my own songs.
And that's something you taught me there.
It's exciting.
Yeah, and that's definitely a Donato class that I went through. You know, work on your own music. One of the greatest excitements is that I listened to my son last night saying, Dad, you're pretty popular. he was like, just to know that he's seeing the pattern, because at this point the bar is being set for him.
Yes.
To move to the next level, use my shoulders to become greater. But I definitely, the whole ideal of being stuck behind the background as a producer, even side guy, I'm kind of pulling myself away from the whole side guy. Because I want the sound.
You want
to
tell your story for real.
Right.
And you know, I know you said, you know, initially you were an introvert, but you know, you're such a great guy. Like, and See, I like this part of the business where, you know, Alan's going through a lot of work stage to stage, and you go out and you greet people. That's part of the joy of what we do live. We get to connect. I mean, it's not hokey to me. I live it.
Right.
But
right.
You've got that charisma, and to deny that, you know, and not propel it with tunes, and, you know, I'm just excited for you, you know.
So, Nate, how did you become a recording artist in smooth jazz? How'd that happen?
By default. Literally, it was something I never looked to do. I remember I wrote a song. When I wrote a song called My Angel.
Oh, that's great.
And when I wrote My Angel, I was actually wrote it, and then I went overseas with Jesse J. It was me, Jesse J, Najar, and a couple of other fine musicians, and we were actually performing in Kosovo for the troops, for the NATO troops. And then when I was there, I let Nate hear the song. He called Woodward Avenue and was like, listen, you need to tap into what's going on. And that's kind of how it moved from there.
Mm. Wow, that's amazing. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so they gave you a contract, like?
He called me. He was like, what else? Mark Norman Coleman. He was like, what else
he's
do you
really
have?
Good with that, like singles deals.
Yeah.
I love that because he did that with Roberto Valli.
Mm-hmm.
And Roberto was everybody's sideman, and I said, dude, you can do it. Just be that guy. And then I actually got him a gig in Vegas as a solo guy with tracks. He says,
oh, wow.
Well, I've never done that before. I said, all you have to do is this, and this, and do it. He goes, I did it.
You know, he's no joke as a songwriter either.
No.
Great.
He's very disciplined, though. You know, that's one part of the business that people don't see. You know, Roberto Valli and Jeff Carruthers, they get together weekly and they write.
Oh,
even
wow.
if they have nothing, they write, and it's impressive. But anyway, you know, credit to you. Look at that. We have no time left, but I would love to quickly talk about your new record. I love the mix of that record. You got Intimate. You've got stuff like Sweet Moments.
Yeah, featuring Marion Meadows.
And you got Swing City with
Jasmine Gent.
With Baby Supermodel.
Yeah. That's my girl.
And Vibe and Bounce with Gerald Albright.
Gerald Albright and Rod Bonner.
And I like that Caramia. What's that?
Caro Mil Bien. That was the first song that I learned in college. It was a classical song.
It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. That's what I love about you, though. Your recorded piano sound is really nice. It's just, it really hits you in the heart.
You know, that's one of the things I try to cater towards my sound. I'm infatuated with the fact that sax players and guitar players can make their instruments sound like a voice.
Mm.
It's hard to make the piano sound dynamically like a voice. So I always try to figure out ways I could touch it where it kind of comes across with those emotional highs and lows.
What I like about your music is a lot of people say that smooth jazz is instrumental R&B, and I think you're right in that sweet spot of instrumental R&B.
Yeah.
You know, you still have that R&B vibe, but you have the chops to do the jazz vibe. It's a great, great mixture, I think.
Yeah, I'm going to tell you, it's going to be something tomorrow night when we do this Harville show. If you don't have your ticket,
yes,
I mean,
be there.
I need you to come,
yes,
support it. Because
Harville's tomorrow.
I promise you, it's going to be an experience. I mean, because I am going to be.
Can
I'm
men
doing
go
a lot
as,
more.
Can men go as well?
Of course. we have seats in the balcony for you.
Exactly.
Well, he's not going to play his guitar to you. I'm sorry.
But I mean, tomorrow. I mean, I'm adding more vocal stuff. I have an outstanding cast of musicians: Amari Williams from Boney James, my girl Dren, that is the keyboard player for the Jacksons. I have who's we have on guitar?
Hash Jenga.
Now is EJ gonna make a cameo?
EJ is actually going to be. He's actually leaving in the morning.
No, he's
so
not.
He can get ready for the school because he's graduating. So I'm like, you got to go back. You got to get to school on
school.
Time, right?
Yes.
So this is his last semester.
Yeah. Another thing about this man's
one more.
Artistry
and Nate Kearney.
Yes,
he'll be with us too on bass.
Well, you know what?
How do people get tickets? We haven't even told you.
Well, first of all, you can go to jazzcatent.com, which is JAZZKAT, and then ENT, short for entertainment.com, and you can purchase tickets on the website.
I would do that because you're going to miss out if you're not there
tomorrow. Mojo.
Well, we've already sold out the VIP section, so the only tickets that are left are general admission tickets.
Yeah.
But it's going to be a great show, and we have
how much? How much is general admission right now?
General admission is $25.
$25.
Come on!
You know what? I'm going to buy a ticket, and I'm gonna donate it to somebody that either calls in or emails me. I'm gonna donate Perfect. One ticket for someone having a tough day. I'll purchase a ticket
nice.
To the appropriate channels.
Thank you, Will.
And I'll donate it to someone that emails me on my website to go see this man. So
okay.
Or they can All go right. out and message you on Facebook, right?
Yes, they
Fine.
Can.
Fine, yeah, but you gotta do it now.
Well, you're not going to outdo me then. I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing.
Oh, what? To your own
gonna,
show?
I'm
to your
offer,
own show?
What the? I'm going to offer.
That's a promoter here.
You know what? I'm giving him my mic now.
I'm going to offer two tickets to what? A couple.
Come on, Jack.
I want a husband and wife. I yes. want a couple to go on and message me on my Facebook page, Alan D. Gray. So A-L-L-E-N. Middle initial D, and then Gray, G-R-A-Y. I want you to message me, and then I want you to come down and enjoy the show.
Yeah. Well,
there's
know
some
what?
Couples out there who are still trying to celebrate Valentine's, I'm sure.
Yeah, and I want people to discover this artist, because
yes.
all of us that have had
So, Nate, how do people get your music?
Well, my music is on all musical platforms, iTunes, Spotify, Google Music, Amazon. Even tell Alexa, play Nathan Mitchell. It all happens. So I'm very excited that you – It's all available on all musical streams. Also, too, I've been encouraging people go onto my YouTube page, you know, subscribe to the YouTube page, my website, www.nathanmitchellmusic.com, and find me also on IG, on Nathan Mitchell Official. Connect. That's the biggest thing. If you Yes. connect with me, because I'm telling you, it's a ride. I got a new album that's going to be dropping. I'll premiere and let you know this now. New album is dropping in August. It is a album that is a tribute to Stevie Wonder, Donny Hathaway, Ooh. and George Duke.
Yeah.
I already have secured, and we're locked and loaded. We have Doobie Powell on there. We have Will Donato on there. We have Donald Hayes.
Ooh,
we have Frank McComb.
Donald. Yes, Frank.
We had him in here.
Yes. And there is more to be added to that. So
great.
You definitely want to.
Well, you know what?
Watch what's
and
going
the name
on.
Of your current album.
Current album is Soulmate. It is literally the final penmanship to an era from tragedy to triumph.
Nice, nicely said.
You know, it's a dedication to love. If you are in love, you believe in love, couples. You want this album. There's a lot of emotions in the album. You can dance to it. You can sit by the fire, mm-hmm. cuddle to it. You cook spaghetti to it. You can.
It sets a vibe. It is
yeah,
a true.
It's a vibe.
It's a vibe that played cover to cover. Because I notice the singles now, the old schoolers, we yeah. want to set a vibe. Put it on at a party and a thing and a wine thing and let it play.
And yeah. the one thing about this album, I did not want to put anything that just sounded passive. I want, because you know, most albums, you have a song that's like first four good.
A filler.
And you just have a filler. I want my albums to have fillers.
I love
every
you,
song.
I love the way you sequence this. It really, yeah. You tell a story and you take us home. I mean, mm-hmm. You really sequence. Did you spend a lot of time sequencing or did it
Literally,
fall?
I play, I mean, Back I would, the way I do it, I mean, when I, if you're ever in the studio, and I think I'll stream this one day, when I'm in the studio, my son will tell you, when I'm playing keys, I will play one note and then I will play it through. And then after that, I will literally sit there and go through it and start. I MIDI everything, but I play it and make sure that the sustains are right. The velocities are correct. I want it to sound like it's moving, you know, sounding like it's connected. Mm. You know, I'm very detailed with that.
You know, I am really proud of this show, and I'll tell you why. Because you got a guy that, you know, came basically in the format 10 years ago, if that, maybe 9. And got to experience on high levels right away from some of the best frontmen and the artists in the game, and one of my favorites. You will not find a better entertainer than Nick Colleone. He might as well just carry a machine gun instead of a guitar. Just
Nick and Brian are on different levels.
Yes, they are. Yeah.
And what I love about him is they never. People don't realize you can see one show and go, "Man, that was great."
They evolve.
They always have a good
they're
show.
They're evolving.
They're always water cooler talk on Monday. It's not, it wasn't yeah. bad. The sound was shitty.
Yeah.
That's the second blue word I said on this show. I said shitty. But those guys, they don't have a bad show. It's like yeah. Cause.
But the thing is, they put the time in, and I use those two I use as models. I mean, you go to a Brian Culberson show, You see lights, camera, action. You see, a lot of energy. Eric Darius, a lot of energy, a lot of movement. Mm-hmm. One thing is that, you know, Marcus Anderson, I would say Marcus is
he
like.
He comes to play.
He is the Michael Jackson on exactly. the sax.
And he dresses like it too.
You know, so at the end of the day, you already know you're going to be entertained. And that's where I'm at right now. You know, James Lloyd, to this day, I'm still trying to figure out how this guy can turn around, literally, and play backwards like this. He's an entertainer.
Yeah, yes. But you know what? You are a very – your ROM and RAM is fully staffed. You just have to pick it up and put it down and copy it because you do that.
Okay, well, speaking of ROM and RAM, he's going to take us home right now.
All right.
So you want to set up this tune for us?
Well, the song is called Simply Beautiful. It literally is just a song just – wrapped around the beauty of passion, love, life. That's it. And you will hear this song will definitely have its place tomorrow night.
Yes.
This is one of my favorites.
You come out with the guitar and song.
Actually,
Will Donato, is that
actually it? This song is one of the songs I just sit behind the piano and I just enjoy it, and you just got to watch me enjoy it.
All right. Okay, everybody. Here we go. Thank you.
Yeah, I think you did it. That is very, that is as vocal as anything I've heard, and you know, I have a couple of listeners that I wanted to give a shout out to real quick for this show. I want to give a shout out to Michelle and Steve Sullins, the owners of Soundbites, and this young man. You should have him in your September Jazz Series. Hmm. They have an amazing club in Sedona, and
oh wow, thank you so much.
Yes, yes. Michelle and Steve, we love you, and I hope you hear this message, because
Sedona's a beautiful place too.
Oh, it's amazing. You know what? I love the show. This is, we haven't done this show for a while, and this, everything about you is natural and organic, and it's not forced, and the courage of you to have all those other skill sets, you really could just sit home and produce. I'm jealous of every one of your loops. They're just perfectly done. If there's an album out called Soulmate 2, don't ask any questions.
Right. Right.
Anyway, it was an honor and a pleasure.
Honor.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone from around the world who's been tuning in. Will and I really appreciate it. Our next show is Saturday, March 7th. Adam Holly, hitmaker. Yes. In the house. Yes. And thanks so much for tuning in. Have a great weekend.
Thank you guys for tuning in.
All right.
Thank you.
You are a brand ambassador, dude. Brand ambassador.
Inside the Music with saxophonist Will Donato and co-host Jack Cohen. We bring you renowned recording artists and musical guests.